Hi all, I've been formulating a non-Vega video, but today there's some news about Vega that I had to cover. AMD released a diagram of Vega's high-level layout, and immediately the biggest concern I had with potential Vega performance shortfall was eliminated. If you've seen my recent Vega videos, you would know that AMD's design with GCN has always focused heavily on compute performance. This is reflected in the inclusion of many stream processors relative to geometry engines, which is actually the graphics portion of a GPU. You could say as a portion of graphics versus compute performance, GCN is always heavily skewed towards compute, and this was because of two reasons. Firstly, AMD wanted to penetrate into the lucrative HPC market, and so they had to offer more teraflops than the competition at a given die size or power. Secondly, as you all know, GPU architecture designs take many years, and back then AMD believed that games would utilize more compute-based effects by the time GCN was brought to market. Of course, in hindsight, we know that this was a slow process. Very much like multi-threading for CPUs, there's always a resistance to change, but eventually, once that barrier is broken, the flood comes. As we are now truly in the multi-thread era, similarly for advanced games, compute-based effects are common and increasing with each game engine iteration. The GCN architecture is limited by the original 4 shader engine design with a max of 4 geometry engines. This is the major reason why Fury X did not scale well in performance relative to its teraflop potential. As more compute units are piled into a shader engine, the depth often becomes too much for scheduling to saturate, so there's many idling stream processors. This is further compounded by bottlenecks in geometry processing and rasterization in the front end. You could say all of the potential teraflops in GCN were shackled, and it's why AMD GPUs needed higher raw teraflops to compete against NVIDIA's GPUs in gaming. AMD has been quite coy with Vega, perhaps too much so. Even the Linux drivers with Vega support list legacy mode options along with 4 shader engines. This lack of info has led to a lot of doubts whether Vega can really be competitive, because we assumed it carries a lot of baggage from GCN. This is the reason why when I saw Vega's architecture diagram, I knew right away this is GCN unshackled, all of its potential teraflops can now run wild for graphics workloads. With 8 geometry engines, Vega can process at a minimum twice the polygons per clock compared to GCN. However, this does not factor in the new programmable features of the geometry engine, namely the compute-based primitive shaders. AMD claims Vega with 4 geometry engines can be up to 2.6 times faster than Fury X with its 4 geometry engines. This, however, relies on primitive shader usage, and there's concerns whether it requires active developer coding to utilize, or if it's a feature which AMD can switch to in their drivers. In my last Vega video, I reasoned that it is possible for AMD to intercept and switch to primitive shaders on a per game basis, so they can still obtain a performance gain when games do not specifically code for it. Obviously, this requires a lot of driver effort, hence it was a major concern whether AMD could pull this off for many games. But with 8 geometry engines, it would not matter whether primitive shaders are utilized or not, since the polygon per clock doubles, and with higher clocks and discard functions on Vega, it should never be geometry bottleneck in games. And if somehow AMD needs even more geometry performance, they can always apply primitive shaders for that specific title. If you recall from my drivers video, I talked about how Vega must be designed to be immune to NVIDIA's strategic efforts to bottleneck AMD GPUs. Vega should accomplish this with its NVIDIA-like overpowered geometry performance. As a consequence, tessellation-based effects such as God rays, hairworks, turfworks, or any geometry-based raycasting effects will run very fast on Vega. Combined with other improvements in Vega, and if AMD did not bite off more than they could chew to get drivers optimized, Vega should perform in games closer to its teraflops rating relative to NVIDIA GPUs. Though importantly, this is AMD playing catch-up to Pascal. And as I talked about, Volta is a looming threat not too distant in the horizon. However, there's also reasons to be optimistic about AMD's competitiveness against Volta, but I will cover that in another video. Oh, by the way, I guess we all know why Vega is so delayed for PC gamers now. Apple, they're taking them all for the new iMac Pro, and Pro drivers have obviously been the focus at AMD, so gamers will just have to wait a little bit longer. Just know that the narrative with AMD GPUs has been more compute or HPC focused architectures, but Vega actually shifts that back towards gaming with a more balanced design. Regardless of how Vega turns out, this balanced approach is the right one, as PC gaming has shown it can generate huge profits. This is a short one, as I wanted to get it out ASAP. I've got a few other interesting topics for future videos in the works, so thanks for watching, and I'll see you all next time.